Greetings and welcome to the show. Ladies, have I got something for you. This show is going to be dedicated to ladies who are yet in pursuit of finding their right one. I'm going to give you 13 must-haves. 13 must-haves. 13 things that a man must have if he's even going to consider going out with you or considering marriage or engagement with you. So, get your pen and paper. Take some notes. These are 13 must-haves. And if we have time, I'll give you 4 quick steps to knowing you have the right man. 4 quick steps to knowing you have the right man. Listen, number 1, a man must have a job. A job. In other words, he must be able to work. He must have the ability to work. If he doesn't have a job, ladies, you know, tell him to catch you when he gets one. Don't wait for him to get one or kind of work through it. Occupy your time until he gets one. You know, he may be fine and cute, but sometimes you have to let that go, because fine and cute doesn't buy groceries or pay the bills sometimes. Number two, ladies, he needs to have a vision. He needs to have a vision. He must have a vision from God. He must be able to see ahead. In other words, he must be able to forecast. No vision is accomplished without resources. He's going to need to know where he's going to take you. If you're going to partner with someone, if you're going to connect with a guy, he needs to know what direction he is going. He needs to have an idea not only of where he's going, but he needs to have an idea for you and your children, if there are children involved. So he must have, number one, a job. Number two, he must have a vision, which means he must be a thinker, one who thinks and processes ahead, doesn't only live for the now. Although he's very effective in the present, he has a plan for the future. Number three, every man must have a little money. Money. Money provides options. Ladies, I know you like options. Amount of money is relative to the relationship. You may say, how much? You know, how much does he need to have? It's relative to your relationship. If you're used to living off $100,000 a year, then you certainly can't date a guy who only makes $5,000 a year, because the amount of money must be relative to your established lifestyle. So be realistic, though, about your needs and lifestyle. Don't try to pick a man based on what you would like to have in the future, or you have this astronomical idea or concept of how much you want to make. Have it clear in your mind about what it is you can live well off of, what your needs are, and then be able to provide some wants and a little cushion to be able to be a blessing to other people. In other words, determine your cost, know your worth as a woman. Know your value. In other words, if he comes to you offering you a dollar dance and you know you're worth $10, don't bring yourself down to those standards. Listen, there are other men who meet your qualifications. There are men out there who meet your specific desired needs. And I think that's the reason for diversity. There are different men on different levels, just like there are different women on different levels. Number four. Every man must have a house, which means he may own, he may rent, or an apartment. In other words, let's call it this, a place to cover you from the elements, a place to cover you from the elements. Determine if it is adequate enough for you to live in. Now, he may have a bachelor pad, and it's not big enough for the two of you. So he needs to have a place that is conducive to a comfortable living for you and himself and children, again, if they are involved or part of the future plan or marriage. It doesn't matter if it's leased or owned by him, at least at this point. The goal, of course, would be to get to a place where you can purchase the property or own the property. Nonetheless, he needs to have some place to put you. I don't believe that it's in the best interest of the male to move into the place of the female. Again, there's all kinds of complications, and this comes from 20 years of counseling and marriage and relationships, being very clear on the fact that the property and the amount of worth and value comes into play if relationships go bad. And so some people use those assets as mediums to control you. So don't want to get into that at this point, but nonetheless, those are some of the issues. Number five, he must have a relationship with God. This, ladies, is not an option. If he does not have a relationship with God, he must be in church getting fed the word of God on a regular basis. In other words, those of you who may not even be Christians, you need a man who is a seeker of spiritual things. Certainly, you need someone who is able to see beyond himself, who is able to recognize logically that there is more to this realm than just the physical or the biological. So, number six, he needs to have goals and objectives. Goals and objectives. Ask him about his five-year plan. He may not have a 10-year plan or 15-year plan, but he ought to have a five-year plan. Any man with a one-year plan, that's not good enough. A one-year plan is obvious. A one-year plan sort of sets itself in motion because you enter the year already with obligations that usually extend about a year or so into it. So he must have a projected five-year plan. In other words, what does he want to accomplish this year? What does he want to accomplish in the next 5 years? His response should be concrete. It should be measurable. Something like, I want to stop cursing, or I want to purchase a house, or I want to stop smoking. In other words, it should be something tangible or something that you can see, a response that is measurable. So in 5 years, you want to see things that have actually been accomplished and be able to check them off the list. So if he hem-haws and says, oh, it kind of just gives you some vague, ambiguous things that he wants to accomplish and there's no way to measure them, then he has no real plan. Number seven, he must have an education. Ladies, at least a high school degree or GED. Education brings exposure. Education brings exposure. So it's not just for the smarts. It's the disciplines, it's the principles, the values that are learned that a man must learn to implement over his lifetime. So education often brings exposure. High school, the further it goes up, the further the exposure is. High school exposes you to more. College exposes you to more. Graduate school exposes you to more. Courses abroad exposes you to more. So there's always an advantage. There's always an advantage to more education. He needs to understand politics and economics. He needs to understand how the world functions. If he can only tell you about him, and his world only as he knows it in a narrow-mindedness, then he's not an option for you to date. He must have some concept of politics. He must have some concept of our nation, some concept or idea or viewpoint on politics and policies, thoughts and economics, revenues, some future financial plan, so on and so forth. So make sure that you connect with someone who has education. Number eight. He must be healthy. He needs to have a good relation. He must have a healthy family background. Healthy family background, excuse me. He needs to have a good relationship with his parents. If he had a dysfunctional upbringing, okay, that may be fine, but find out how was he healed. Has he been healed over time? Does he or did he have a play mother or a mentor? If he didn't have a regular mother, or if he wasn't raised by his biological mother, who raised him? Find out if there is a considerable amount of dysfunction. Now, every family has an amount of dysfunction, but it's how we respond to it that makes the difference in our progressive futures. If he has not chosen to do anything with it, if he's anti-counseling or self-introspection, then you don't want to deal with them, because every person has to do some healing once they come out of their family. Number nine, check on his friends. He must have friends. Every man must have friends. Male or female friends are fine. Pay attention to see if he has more male friends or female friends. That makes a difference. Can't get into that now. A lot of women in his life may be a problem for you. You will have to determine what you can handle. If you're a jealous woman, you're insecure, you don't like a lot of other women around, and he has women friends, he needs to be upfront with you from the beginning. Let you know right off the bat. If you can't handle that, you need to not date him. Get a guy with a good crop of male friends. You need a male who can bond and connect with other males. There's a transference that occurs when a male spends time with other male, which reduces a lot of anger and temper and anxiety. So that's very, very important. Do not pursue a man who is isolated, who has no friends. He should have at least one good friend, male or female. And this is beyond the ordinary associate friend category. This is a good friend, one that he's had for maybe 10 years, 20 years plus. If he can't talk to you, he needs to talk to someone. A friend might be objective to help him work through his problems. He's going to need that because he's not going to be able to tell you everything, at least not right away in the relationship. Strength is determined by resistance. So do not always rescue the man. Allow him to control some of the situations. I know that women often want to be able to rescue their man and help them through difficult situations, but strength is determined by resistance. He must be able to resist circumstances, resist temptations, resist situations himself, garnering more internal strength to be the kind of man that you need him to be in the relationship. Don't be afraid of a test. Don't be afraid of a test. Just because a test is present doesn't mean the man is doing something wrong. Wait until something wrong is actually done before you accuse. There may be some things that come to test you, but don't give in to just a test. Wait until you actually find concrete evidence or for the situation before you begin to accuse. Don't speak generalities when you're dealing with your man. If you have an accusation, be very specific about it. Come very clear. Don't go around in circles. You'll anger him and cause more rebellion. Number 10, he needs to have a car. Transportation is a must. Or if he doesn't have a car, he needs to be able to get you around to different places. He needs to be able to transport you or supply you with your own transportation, given the fact that the relationship may involve you all spending lots of time together. Number 11, he needs to have passion. He must have passion and ambition. You need to be able to see what he is passionate about. You should be able to see the gleam in his eye. You should be able to know what excites him. If you can't see a gleam in his eye, if he sits around with his jaw hanging and drooling and tired and never has any energy to do anything, sister, that's a wreck waiting to happen. You don't want to be connected with a guy who has lost his passion. Now, he may still be a very good guy, but something has to happen in him first before he enters into a relationship. Otherwise, he'll pull you down and misery loves company. Number 12, must have communication. A man must have communication. He must be able to talk to you. He must be willing to talk to you. He must be willing to talk to you. He must be able to talk to you. A man must be able to express his emotions. He must be able to express how he feels about you. He must be able to tell you, I love you, though he may choose not to say it all the time. He must be able to. If push comes to shove, the matter gets really cranky, he needs to be able to talk about a situation so as to provide clarity and guidance for the relationship. Number 13, and finally, every man must be able to understand the difference between a ruler versus rule. In other words, he must be able to rule versus the gift of rule. The gift of rule is spiritual. Men and women can possess this gift. Being able to rule is in every man. God predestined it to be. He must be able to take charge. He must be able to determine what he is in charge of in his life. Women often like men, you know, to be able to take charge. That's why they like bad boys. Bad boys seem like they can make decisions and do certain things. And there are some women who like to be controlling and they want to control their man, but then get mad at him because he doesn't make decisions. You must be able to find the balance in that. You must be able to have a working relationship with your mate, one which he allows you to have input in decision making and conversation, but you also must give him room to rule. So he must be able to rule, he must be able to make decisions, he must be able to make mistakes on his own as well and be able to fix them. Well, those are 13 things that every man must have. I think I'm out of time and I won't be able to share with you the 4 quick steps of knowing you have the right man. You'll have to pick up with me on the next time. But thank you for tuning in on today, and we will pick up on some new concepts in the next show on male and female. Until next time. Have a great and prosperous day.